I'm Nicole Swern, and I'm part of an independent facilitation team from Swern Inc. that's working with the city and CreateTO to support their Housing Now engagement work, including the project here at 1631 Queen East. The site may be more familiar to you as the current home of Beach's Employment and Social Services offices and the Coxwell Early Learning and Childcare Center. Our team's role is to help facilitate discussion and to connect the engagement and feedback and advice received to decision-making. We're not here to advocate for any particular outcome of this work or on any of the projects we work on. Our job is to help facilitate discussion, take a lot of notes, and make sure that the feedback that you provide is part of CreateTO's and the city's thinking as it continues to move forward with their work at 1631 Queen East. This is the first community consultation meeting, and we will be seeing you again in the future, we hope. We have played, and our firm has played, the same role on other Housing Now projects, and you may have heard of the initiative. It's been going on in the city for a bit of time now. So I'm going to turn it over in a minute to Councillor Brad Bradford, but before I do, I'm honored to give the land acknowledgement on behalf of CreateTO and the City of Toronto Housing Now team. And the acknowledgement is one way that settler descendants and non-Indigenous Canadians like me offer our proper respect as allies and supporters of Indigenous peoples on Turtle Island. I'm a Scarborough baby, not so far from the site, well, a lot further east and north. But in any case, I'm a child of immigrants. My mother came from East Germany on my father's side, my grandfather from the Ukraine. And when we root that acknowledgement in ourselves personally, it helps remind me and helps remind us all to be mindful of the treaties still in place and the peoples that lived here long before us. The 1631 Queen Street East lands are covered by Treaty 13 with the Mississaugas of the Credit. And these lands are the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples. We know Toronto is home today to many diverse First Nation, Métis, and Inuit peoples. So I encourage you, wherever you are, to learn about and acknowledge the territory, the traditional territory you're in, get to know more about the treaties signed in that traditional territory, and get to know the peoples who are an important part of the area you live in. So with that, I'll review the agenda in a minute, but before I do, I'd like to turn it over to your counselor, Brad Bradford. Adjacent counselor Paula Fletcher unfortunately sends her regrets, but she's got staff listening in tonight. Hi to Susan, I see you on the list there. But over to you, Councillor Bradford.
Thanks very much, Nicole, and good evening, folks. Here we are again, another WebEx, another online gathering, but still a great opportunity to connect. And it's fantastic to be here with you. I want to start by just saying I'm personally very excited about this project and what we are going to build here together as a community. When we first launched our Housing Now program, kind of the beginning of the term, I was really happy to see us as a city, Toronto here, taking tangible steps to actually deliver on our commitments to housing. But I'd have to admit, I was a little bit disappointed that we hadn't landed on a site in our community. I know the East End is full of folks who care deeply about this city, and full of folks who want to make a difference. And so not to have a site in our neck of the woods was a little disappointing, but here we are with the second tranche. I think we learned a lot from the first parcels of land, and we have a really marquee site right here on Queen Street that will be a landmark for the East End. So everyone in our community and in the city has a story about housing affordability. And that's either themselves directly or somebody they know. Could be your kids, could be your parents, could be folks who move to Toronto, move here for the promise of new opportunity, folks who come here for an education. Whatever the reason is, housing and a place to call home is one of the most fundamental needs. It is universal for all of us. And what we're talking about tonight is creating a mixed income community right here, as Nicole was alluding, on Queen Street, Coxwell and Queen. We're building homes for average Toronto residents, the people who make our communities a special place as they are, our frontline workers, everyone from TTC bus drivers to nurses to teachers to young professionals. There's certainly a range of housing affordability needs in Toronto, and we have to just be honest that no one project can address them all. And that's why we need to be making moves as a city, as a community, both big and small, across the entirety of the housing spectrum to actually move the needle on this important file. So I want to encourage everyone online tonight to see this project and the discussions that we're starting out as today as contributing to a very specific goal. And that's about adding new rental housing, new affordable rental housing to our community and our city. There are many other sites across Toronto and projects that are fulfilling needs and serving other residents as well. And some of the conversations that we're going to have tonight and in subsequent discussions are going to be about trade-offs and balance. I was a former planner myself before I stumbled into this job. And those are the type of conversations that you have on any project. Through the process, we're going to be talking about the trade-off between density and affordable housing. The formula is fairly simple, and we'll hear more about that. The more units we have, the more housing that we are able to deliver. And I want to be clear about my views on this, my personal views. We have to find the right balance. We need a reasonable and sustainable amount of density on this site. We have to respect the planning framework, and we have some fantastic staff that are working on this file. And we want to make sure that the site and the project is livable, and a welcoming community that contributes to the vibrancy of Queen Street. And certainly there's a lot of room to improve that. But we also have to push the envelope in order to meet our affordable housing goals. And that doesn't happen when you're nicking away at opportunities to bring new units. And I know that, like I said off the top, this is a community of builders, this is a community that cares, and this is a community that knows we can make a difference. So we're gonna do that together. I also know that we have a strong commitment to, not just ourselves, but recognizing the role that we can play here across the city as EastEnders. So I'm grateful that you're on the line tonight to make your voice heard and to participate in the community-led change. And I'll wrap by just saying, I want to thank the team that's been involved in putting this project together. Annalise, Chantel, Paul, Bob, the folks from SWERN, CreateTO, Planning. We really are in good hands with these folks. Some of the best staff in the city are working on this file. And we're at the very beginning of the process. So I encourage you to take the time to get to know them. I know it's a little bit harder virtually, but to engage with them deeply, send the emails, strike up the phone calls, get involved, and let's start forging a great partnership tonight. We also have Claudine and Rishab from my office, who will be the point people on this file. And as Nicole mentioned, our friend and colleague to the West, Councillor Fletcher, she's not here tonight, but Susan from her office is here, and she will be involved in the process as well going forward. Lastly, this area has a rich Indigenous history. As a city, as part of Steps for Reconciliation, as a community, we are very deeply committed to recognizing and honoring that history in a really thoughtful and meaningful way. So we've been engaging with various Indigenous groups here across the city and East End and the East End, and partners will be a key component of this application here. We will be doing a series of both Indigenous sharing and placekeeping meetings, and I will be participating in those as well and receiving your input and feedback to really make this application as strong and thoughtful as possible. And we have Bob Gullis on the line as well, who will be leading our Indigenous consultation efforts and making sure that we come up with a really great application. So I'm going to leave it there, turn it back over to Nicole and the team at Create. And thanks again, my gratitude for you taking your time to be here tonight, and looking forward to the conversation.
Thank you very much, Councillor. So we're going to just pull the agenda for tonight up onto the screen, and I'll walk through it with you so you have a sense of how we're planning on using the time. The purpose of the meeting is for the city and CreateTO to introduce the Housing Now initiative, present the site context for 1631 Queen Street East, introduce the concept of Indigenous placekeeping on site and Kishigo Lane, and present and seek feedback on early ideas for a preliminary development concept for the site. They're going to, as soon as I'm sort of done setting the stage, The presentation team will start, and we think they will take about 30 minutes to give you what will be a detailed briefing on the project here. And then after they're done, the rest of the meeting is for discussion. We think you will have some questions very likely based on the material shared. And we encourage you to ask those, and we'll facilitate answers. And we also have some questions for you. And I always like to review those before the presentation so you can have them in the back of your mind. What the city and CreateTO are most interested in understanding is really the important features of your existing neighborhood that they need to consider and think about when they redevelop the site. You live there, you are in those areas all the time. What are those features in your neighborhood that you want them to keep front of mind as they think about the future of the site? That's the first question. The second question is really, are there opportunities that this project can take advantage of to enhance the local neighborhood? And I think that you'll see the team has already done some thinking in that regard, but you may have some other ideas. So any opportunities to enhance the local neighborhood through the project? Or do you have any concerns about the redevelopment of the site? And if you do, what suggestions do you have, if any, on how to address them? And then, of course, if those questions don't work for you, we always say, do not worry about it. Whatever you came to say or whatever comes to your mind in terms of feedback, we would love to hear it. And the notice that went out to the community, we had over 3,300 residents and businesses that had a mail drop, and some people have already made it to the website and filled out the feedback form already. So if you don't have a chance to raise your hand or participate tonight, you can also use asynchronous mechanisms. Whether you want to request a hard copy of materials, we will mail it to you and mail you a workbook to fill out and send back. Whether you want to do it online, or whether you have friends or other neighbors that you think might be interested. So that is it. At about 8:25, we will wrap up and talk about next steps. And I'd like to, just before we start, we'll maybe take down the agenda and introduce the people that will be presenting. I think they're all on camera now. And when I say your name, maybe just give people a wave so that they can put a face to a name. So from CreateTO, we have Chantel. Nice. And from City Planning, we have Annalie and Maladin. Nice. Great. Thank you. From the City's Housing Secretariat, Valessa. Wonderful. And from SVN and Turo, these are two consultants that are working for the City and CreateTO on this. So from SVN and Turo, we have Sony and Audrey from SVN. Audrey, Sony, great. And then from Turo, we have Brian. Nice. Okay. And last but not least, from Nibsing Consulting, we have Bob Goulet, who is leading Indigenous engagement. And the most colorful shirt. It's nice to bring a little spot of life. Okay, so before we start, couple of final words in terms of mechanics. You might have noticed that there's a recording dot on your screen, and we are recording the meeting. We do this with all the Housing Now meetings, and CreateTO will put the recording on the Housing Now website after the meeting, and we add captioning to make it even easier to get your head around what people are saying. And we wanted everybody just to know that. Our facilitation team is also going to take detailed notes and will prepare a summary of the discussion. We will send that summary to you in draft, and it's not a verbatim transcript. It's really our work to try and synthesize the main points coming out of the discussion. It's also a nice, easy, and shorthand way to get a handle on what was shared and the feedback received. And for now, all of you have your mic off and your camera off. But when the presentation is over, we're going to make everybody going to turn on or give everybody the possibility of putting on their camera and turning on their mic. And you don't have to turn your camera on if you don't want. You don't have to turn your mic on, but we'll leave those controls to you. But for now, I'll just ask everyone to stay muted on their microphone. And I will not intervene in those controls unless there's some kind of very disruptive noise. And I guess the last thing, when you log out or leave the meeting, there is going to be a short form where you can sign up for updates. It's kind of like a sign-in sheet that you would do at an in-person meeting. And we're hoping you'll fill that out. Councillor, I see that you put your hand up. Are you practicing putting your hand up, or do you want to jump in again before we start? I think you're muted too.
Oh, I was just saying that's ancient from before the meeting even started. Let me put that down for everyone.
But that's a good hint because everybody else can also then practice putting their hand up and taking their hand down. Wonderful. Okay, so I will just hand it over to Annalie Zonina from the city to start us off. Annalie, over to you.
Thanks, Nicole. And yeah, oh, here's the presentation. Great. Okay, here we are on December 7th. Go ahead, Matthew, can change the slide. So I think we got a little bit of an idea from the introduction about who is here tonight. And I just wanted, for those of you who aren't familiar with CreateTO and how the Housing Now initiative is run. Housing Now initiative is an initiative of the City of Toronto, and it's jointly managed by the Housing Secretariat, City Planning, and CreateTO. So we have the Housing Secretariat here today, whose responsibility is about the depth of affordability and number of affordable units. We from City Planning are taking the lead on the update to the planning frameworks. That means the zoning bylaw and the other permissions that enable a mixed-use building of the size that we're contemplating right now to be developed on the site. And CreateTO is the city's real estate agency. So they are working not only with city planning and coordinating the outreach to the community, but also other users of the site who are from the city. So for example, Children's Services and Toronto Employment and Social Services to find good quality locations for them either on the site or within the vicinity. Next. So tonight's presentation is a very simple agenda. Hopefully we can get through it in the half hour that Nicole pointed to. First, I'd like to introduce to you what the Housing Now initiative is for those of you who may not be familiar with it. Secondly, we'll go through a little bit of a context and walk around of the Queen Street East site. And then we'll look to ideas for the future, principles for the design and the Indigenous placekeeping on the site. And then we'll open it up for discussion. So a little bit about Housing Now. Housing Now was launched and adopted at City Council as an initiative of the city in December in 2018. And the key principle of Housing Now is to use city-owned land to accelerate the development of affordable housing. So that means leveraging our public lands for public benefits. Affordable housing is a main and central goal of the program, but we also look to other items like community benefits that can serve the area. So in the case of 1631 Queen Street, that relates to the children's services space, the daycare, and improvements and enhancements to the public realm. Throughout, we're looking at mixed income and mixed use developments near transit or transit supportive. And we do more consultation on Housing Now site than we may do for a standard development application, owing to its complexity and the extraordinary opportunities we have at these locations. Next. This is an image here that shows the spectrum of tenure types and affordabilities of housing available in the City of Toronto. And what we've done is just highlight the types of housing in terms of tenure and affordability that Housing Now focuses on. So that includes affordable rental housing and market rental housing at this site. So the site is proposed to be rental. On our larger sites where there are more blocks of development, we have the opportunity to also introduce market home ownership to augment the program, support it financially, and to continue to provide a range of housing options. Next. So Housing Now is a citywide program, and this is an image of the City of Toronto, a map of the City of Toronto with all the Housing Now sites identified. And the Housing Now sites vary considerably in size and complexity. So we have some sites that are full master plan new neighborhoods, for example, the two dots that are located in Etobicoke, above the word Etobicoke. And we have many sites that are individual buildings, and they also demand a lot of attention to do it right and to maximize affordable housing opportunities while providing a high quality development for the area. But they are citywide, reflective of the fact that it is a citywide program. Next. So Housing Now, as Councillor Bradford mentioned, is really about providing affordable rent for people who are living and working in the city of Toronto, but for whom the affordability crisis has meant that those working in the city may have difficulty finding a home in the city where they work and where they support a vibrant quality of life for all of us. So here on this slide, we have some images of frontline workers or end of retired person. So we know right now during COVID, frontline workers are so critical to the health of our city and to our ability to recover and survive the pandemic. So you'll see that their incomes range between or the ones that we're highlighting here from an early childhood educator. That income is at $35,000 or almost $36,000 up to a licensed practical nurse, just over $50,000. And we also have neighbors in the Indigenous community who are dealing with average annual incomes of below that range. So all told, we have an affordability crisis. I think a lot of people are aware of that. But what the Housing Now program is looking to is trying to find a way to move away from people who are so critical to the health of the city from paying up to 83% of their income on housing. Next. Just to give you a sense of how we've done so far on the Housing Now programs, these are the first four priority sites that were that achieved rezonings in late 2019 and early 2020. And you'll see the range of community uses and facilities that we've been able to bring forward through the zoning. And we expect the icons indicate what those are. So public space, new public streets, public parks, and we expect that we will be able to also similarly on 1631 Queen Street achieve benefits beyond the housing itself. Next. I'll pass it over to Chantel.
Thank you very much, Annalee. So with every Housing Now file, we look to maximize the number of affordable units that can be delivered on the site. We also look to ensure that the new development is compatible with its surrounding context and meet key accessibility criteria. So for this site specifically, we are aiming to deliver 300 new rental units. 50% of those will be affordable rental and the remaining 50% will be market rental. The preliminary design incorporates creative approaches to integrate density while meeting objectives of the Queen Street East Urban Design Guideline and also prioritizing design excellence. With respect to accessibility, we are meeting council direction on the accessibility requirements. So that means 20% of all affordable rental units will be accessible and 15% of all market units will be accessible. In addition to that, we also will ensure that all common areas will be designed to be fully barrier-free. On a broader note, the objectives for 1631 Queen Street East include the incorporation of Indigenous placekeeping. So as Councillor Bradford mentioned at the top of the meeting, this site presents an exciting opportunity to recognize Indigenous peoples who have lived in this territory for thousands of years. The site is located next to a former road, Kishigo Lane, that was named to honor an Anishinaabe family that lived in the area in the late 18th century. So we'll be working with the city and the Indigenous community, as well as our designers, Turo Espien and Bob Goulet, who is our Indigenous facilitator, to convert this space into a publicly accessible open space that celebrates the Indigenous history of the area. Party to that will also be the inclusion of Indigenous design principles that will be within the build form, and the team will walk you through those preliminary design principles in more detail later on in tonight's presentation. With respect to the public realm, that will be enhanced further along Eastern Avenue, and the connection to Woodbine Park and the beach will be reinforced as well. Engagement will be conducted throughout the process and in an authentic and meaningful way with the community and with Indigenous people. And as Annalee noted as well, this site will include an expanded childcare center that will increase the capacity from the current 26 spaces to 62 spaces. Next. So this slide illustrates the general stages of the delivery for a typical Housing Now project, including this one. We are currently at the beginning of stage one, at the beginning of the process, so developing a preliminary design concept and sharing with you today the thinking on that design concept, as well as the vision and design principles. The second stage encompasses the delivery of a final design concept and takes us through the city-initiated rezoning process. Stage three will involve final council approval of that concept, as well as the rezoning, and will take us through the procurement and award of a development partner. Now in stage four, the development partner will lead the detailed design work and take the project through the site plan approval process and obtain building permits to, and then also construct the building. One thing to note, as Annalee also noted, is that consultation happens throughout the process and distinctly through stage one, stage two, and then again in stage four. So we're with you today conducting our first round of consultation, and our second round of consultation is set to is planned to take place in spring of 2021. The development partner will consult with you again through the stage four, as I mentioned, sharing with you detailed designs that include proposed materials and colors, and that will take place in 2022. Now, specific to this project is, as I mentioned, the inclusion of engagement of the Indigenous community. This will happen throughout the concept development stages and will also be a requirement for the development partner through stage four. So the team will share more details about this process later on in the presentation. Also following tonight's presentation, we will be presenting this material at the design review panel, and a second visit to the design review panel will take place in 2022, led by the design development partner. And then lastly, construction is anticipated to commence in the summer of 2023, with first occupancy planned in the summer or fall of 2025. Now over to Sunny.
Actually, I think it's my turn.
Sorry, Mladen.
No worries. Thanks, Chantel. So in terms of the site context, our site is located southeast of Coxwell Avenue and Queen Street East. As you can see, it has an irregular lot shape. It's more of a V shape, but it has frontages along Queen Street East, as well as Eastern Avenue. And the site also includes Kishigo Lane as well. As you can see, Harvey's Restaurant is not included as part of this site. Next slide, please. What's currently on the site is on the north end along Queen Street East, we have a five-story office building, which is home to the Beaches Employment and Social Services Center. And this building takes up the majority of the Queen Street frontage. Next slide. And on the south end, we have a surface parking lot that's being used by the office building. And as I mentioned before, we also have Kishigo Lane, which is part of the property and provides a mid-block connection between Queen Street East and Eastern Avenue, as well as some parking. Next slide. In terms of the development context, west of our site at 1555 Queen Street, we have the Don Somerville site. This is a large project that includes a 17-story building with TCHC housing, as well as some market rental and condos. At the north of Queen Street, we have 1602 Queen Street, as well as 1624 Queen Street, both of which are six-story mixed-use buildings that are currently under construction. And northeast of our site, at the corner of Queen Street and Kingston Road, we have 1684 Queen Street East, which is also known as the Murphy's Law Pub, which is part of a recently submitted development application for a six-story mixed-use building as well. That proposal is still being reviewed by the city, and no decision has been made on that application yet. Next slide. In terms of the planning framework, in the official plan, which is the city's most important document when it comes to development, our site is located on a designated avenue, and in itself, it's designated as a mixed-use area, which means that intensification is expected to occur on this site, and a variety of different uses are permitted as long as they're compatible. Additionally, we also have site and area-specific policy 466, as well as the urban design guidelines for Queen Street East, which also apply to this site. And these policies and guidelines specify a maximum height of 6 stories along Queen Street, as well as a maximum street wall height of 12.5 meters along Queen Street. And lastly, the current zoning on the site is MCR 2.0, which means that both commercial and residential are permitted, the maximum FSI of 2 times the area of the lot and a maximum height of 4 meters. And that's what's currently permitted to be built on this site with no additional planning approvals or anything. Next slide. And now I pass it on to Sunny, I think.
Thank you. As mentioned before, SVN Architects and Planners, along with Tour Architects, are collaborating on developing the design for both the site and the built form based on Indigenous placekeeping principles. I'll be presenting a preliminary analysis of the site based on the regulatory framework with built form concepts. Audrey, our landscape lead, will walk through landscape concepts, followed by Brian from Turo, who will speak to the Indigenous placekeeping principles that will find their way into the final design. Next slide. This is a view I always like to use when I'm thinking about this site, because it just shows the abundance of open space and amenity space within this neighborhood, and of course the lake beyond. Next slide. This is an older view from a different era of the site, of course. This is taken from the late 1940s. And of course, the Ashbridge's Bay sewage treatment plant at that time was really considered an industrial site. Incineration was taking place, very little odor control. And then of course, Woodbine Racetrack, or sorry, the Greenwood Racetrack really represented a different era of recreational use on the site. And of course, the residential neighborhood north of Queen. Next slide. And then looking at the context today, of course, Ashbridge's Bay sewage treatment plant has really become quite a great recreational and amenity space for the neighborhood. And of course, the residential uses located north of Queen Street are still intact. And then what's really happened is there's this unique island of mixed use in between those spaces that's really continuing to evolve as this neighborhood evolves. Next slide. Then just looking at the larger context, it's a neighborhood that's really well blessed with both large public spaces and park spaces, and also a mix of smaller and medium-sized amenity spaces. Of course, transit connectivity via the streetcar east-west, and then connections via buses to Line 2 heading north. Next slide. And again, a closer look at the site itself. So currently, Eastern is really a vehicular through fare. The condition on Eastern isn't really that great for pedestrians, but with the Don Somerville development and this development, it's really an opportunity to reimagine Eastern Avenue as a really a pedestrian-focused space, really highlighting the ability to create active frontages along that street and really reinvent what Eastern Avenue is. Next slide. This is just a high-level analysis, just highlighting some key kind of opportunities for the site. Of course, establishing a frontage along Eastern Avenue, taking advantage of the views towards the water and the great solar access, and of course, connecting to the existing fabric of Queen Street. And then of course, as was mentioned previously, Gishigo Lane providing an opportunity for a through block connection. Next slide. I'll walk you through some of the site principles that we've developed. Of course, the enhanced public realm through the creation of Gishigo Lane into a publicly accessible open space, of course, at a size that's quite significant. Next slide. And then really what we're trying to do is create connectivity between the Gishigo Lane through the site and then connecting onto the lane that connects to Coxwell Avenue. So really trying to develop a pedestrian connectivity between those two public realms. And then of course, providing vehicular access through the lane from Coxwell and then down through a new connection onto Eastern Avenue to the south. Next slide. This is an example of one of our projects that really looked at doing a similar thing, really converting what is a laneway that's used for service vehicles and parking, but really animating it with bike parking, lobby spaces, community spaces, providing pedestrian access and great light and views to really make it a really an accessible space for pedestrians. Next slide. Looking at the ground floor along Queen Street, we're proposing retail fronting Queen Street along with the childcare space fronting Queen Street. Residential would be fronting Eastern Avenue. And there's a great opportunity with that through block connection through the site to really create a unique space where both that's animated both by the residential uses and the childcare space. Next slide. These are two examples of projects from our office. The one to the left, YWC Elm Street project, which really looks at providing childcare space through block pedestrian connection, vehicular parking, and really orchestrating all of those uses really in a way that all of them could actually enhance one another. And then looking at the project to the right, it's a recently completed childcare center, which really highlights how pedestrian connectivity adjacent to the childcare center can be mediated with light features such as low fences. Next slide. And then just looking at the frontages. So along Queen Street, we're looking to provide a 4-meter setback, really to allow or accommodate street trees, and then connecting to the existing mid-rise fabric along Queen Street. Along Eastern Avenue, we're looking at a taller built form facing the south, and then in between, really a connection piece that mediates between the two and fronts east and west. Next slide. And then in one of the key site constraints is the angular plane. So this is kind of shown with this orange plane that really creates a mid-rise block along Queen Street and then sets back south on a 45-degree angular plane. So it really limits the amount of development that's along Queen Street and enforces the taller built form to be along Eastern Avenue. Next slide. And then this is the view of a preliminary concept that we've developed using all of these principles. So this is a view looking southwest. And what we've really been trying to do is define the development block into three distinct pieces. A mid-rise connected to Queen Street, a taller built form facing south towards Eastern Avenue, and then, as I mentioned before, a middle piece connecting the two, which has taken a really different approach than what was taken at Don Somerville, which had a lot more steps and really followed the angular plane diagram more closely. Next slide. This is a view looking northeast, again looking at the built form along Eastern, the taller built form, but sitting on a 4-story podium to really mediate between the pedestrian realm and the taller building above. Next slide.
Just to state the obvious, the dark gray is the building we're talking about.
Yes, sorry.
I mean, sorry.
The light gray. It's the light gray. Gray. The light
sorry,
gray.
The
My
light
apologies.
Gray, but in the previous picture. Yeah, okay, good.
Yes.
So maybe just make a point of pointing out which one it is.
The Don Somerville, yeah, towards the left, and then the proposed development towards the top right of the slide. My apologies.
Yeah, sorry. Good.
Next slide. And then this is just a street level view along Queen Street, looking west. And then again, really defining the three main blocks of the development. Mid-rise facing Queen Street, taller built form facing Eastern Avenue, and then a middle built form mediating between the two. Next slide. And then again, along Queen Street, looking east, really showing those three distinct forms once again. Next slide. This is a rendered site plan. And then looking towards the top of the page along Queen Street, again, retail frontage along Queen Street, proposing a childcare space on 2 stories. The childcare outdoor space would be on the south connecting to Gishigo Lane. Along the south part of the site, facing Eastern Avenue would be entirely residential uses and really using the bike parking and amenity spaces to help animate that through block connection from the east to the west of the site. And then we're looking at placing the parking garage access and loading towards the west of the site. Now I'll hand it over to Audrey, who can walk through the landscape concepts.
If you go back to the previous slide. So on Queen Street, we are proposing the city standard sidewalk in the street trees and planters. And this provides a landscape frontage to the buildings, retail and childcare faces along Eastern Avenue. We're trying to pedestrianize the public realm, really recognizing that it's an evolving area and tie it into the residential programming at grade. So we're proposing a double row of trees and providing a 3 meter setback from the property line that will be treated with a combination of paving, seating and planting. The east-west laneway will be a mid-block connection as mentioned earlier, and it's primarily pedestrian with the outdoor childcare space, which is that colorful space labeled near the middle of the page. And that's nestled in between our buildings and situated south of the Harvey site and will be fenced in. And we're also proposing a laneway off of Eastern Avenue that is for servicing and leads to the drop-off area for the daycare. Kishigo Lane on the right side of the page is going to be a north-south laneway that is indicated in the green tone on our diagram. And the design of this area will be developed later on as a placekeeping initiative. Next slide. So on Queen Street, we have a 2.1 meter sidewalk adjacent to the roadway with a dedicated 2.7 meter tree and landscape zone with understory planting beneath street trees. And the remaining frontage setback will be either retail or childcare space. Next slide. This is just a perspective sketch along Queen Street looking east. Next slide. Along Eastern Avenue, we'll also have a 2.1 meter sidewalk adjacent to the roadway and a dedicated 2 meter tree and furniture zone. We'll be having trees and some landscaping and some raised planting, or raised planter with potentially seating. And there will be a 4 meter building setback that will be treated with trees and grates, as well as a 3 meter landscape and landscape zone with seating and planting elements and unit paving. Next slide. This is just an Eastern Avenue sketch perspective looking west on Eastern Avenue. Next slide. This is the laneway section taken from the newly proposed laneway coming off of Eastern to our site. So we're proposing a one-way 4.5 meter laneway with a 2.1 meter sidewalk right next to our building. And this will be a dedicated pedestrian 2.1 meter clear way delineated with bollards and a bold curb. Next slide. This is just a perspective sketch of the through block connection. You can see the outdoor daycare in the distance and the drop-off zone is in the foreground. It's really meant to be an animated space that ties into the daycare programming, as well as the lobby and bike programming at the ground floor. Next slide. And now I'll turn it over to Brian, who will walk you through the placekeeping initiatives on the site.
Thanks, Audrey. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Brian Porter. I'm the principal of Touro Architect. We're a fully licensed architecture firm based out of Six Nations of the Grand River, and really grateful for the opportunity to work with this project team on this very exciting project. Next slide, please. So from the land acknowledgement that we heard earlier, we know that the site has been significant for many, many centuries, even those prior to European contact. And Toronto has always been, you know, an integral part of a water-based transportation system that connected Lake Ontario up to Lake Simcoe through some of the rivers that flow into Lake Ontario. To Lake Simcoe and to Lake Huron beyond. So you can see this kind of this historic diagram. So we think it's fitting to look to commemorate and celebrate the natural history of this place. And you know, we're really seeing it kind of pop up with different institutions in the city, you know, that understand that, you know, reconciliation is a good thing. Being able to, you know, celebrate that history is important, you know, it's something that I believe is not threatening, that we could really work together to help this place, you know, achieve a richness that, you know, that the city deserves to have. Next slide, please. You know, when I look at some of the massing studies that have been done, we see lots of opportunities to incorporate indigeneity in ways that, you know, can be done in a timely manner within some of the budgets that are going to be identified. And one of the ones that kind of pops out to me is the whole, like, the aspect of directionality. If you take a look at some of the traditional architectural precedents that are out there with Indigenous communities all over Turtle Island, you see this real strong connection to the four directions. And there's also strong connections to the sky world and the underworld. And for us, you know, these tie into themes like sunrise, sunset, how the sun changes its angle in the sky from being low in the wintertime to high in the sky in the middle of summer. So we think that the way the sun rises and the sun sets and the directionality that we experience, they should have an impact on the way the building is designed and the way it's experienced by its users. So I was really interested when Sunny showed one of the slides in his slide deck kind of showed that the 1631 Queen Street site is already kind of developing this heart where there's a lot of things that are coming together. So if you go to the next slide, we've kind of brought it back here to show how we think those six directions can be enhanced with the project to really kind of heighten our awareness of it. There's already kind of that heart of the facility where they're going to be children. Through the daycare, there's going to be access to the park. So we think this can be a real vibrant part of the design where we can really kind of heighten the awareness of that. So we think there's like a great opportunity there. Next slide, please. And the opportunity for, the outdoors is really huge. We think there's an opportunity there to reference Indigenous art, to promote biodiversity, to consider life cycle stewardship of the land. So here we're showing a Norville Morisot painting that we took some inspiration on when we were doing an Indigenous student center at Laurier University. So we're really sort of taking the land, seeing it as a real asset, and thinking about how we could set up, how we could take advantage of microclimates, how the landscape could be colorful, how we could really kind of promote this biodiversity that would show off Indigenous species. We're really, with this site, we were looking at reinstating a lot of species that were natural to the area. But also very, you know, designing some very sort of quaint places for contemplation, but also some places for maybe larger gatherings. So we're looking at the opportunities that we have to do this type of work on the Queen Street site. Next, please. We're also you know, with food sovereignty is becoming more and more in the news, and I think we should be encouraging projects that try to introduce planting and bring harvesting back into their curriculum. We think there's a real opportunity with that on this project to set up to incorporate species that can be, you know, harvested in the fall. You know, through group activities. You know, it sounds maybe a little bit optimistic, but, you know, we're seeing this kind of work done with more and more institutions, like the University of Toronto is trying to introduce this kind of a program. It's been going on at McGill University for a while. OCAD University is talking about it in Toronto. So just, you know, making it a really kind of a meaningful part of the program, taking advantage of the natural gifts that were offered, like sun and rainwater, and really engaging in the community, is something that we're seeing becoming, more and more. It's more and more talked about in the news all the time. So we think there's an opportunity there. Next slide, please. We've also been talking a lot in our work lately about trying to make living and breathing environments. Like, we share the land with flora and fauna, and animals, and the elements and the wind and the rain. And when you think about rain, for instance, it has just as much right to be on the site as we do. So we're starting to think about accessibility in kind of different ways that are more inclusive to other species. Some examples would be, there's an apiary on the top of the Royal York Hotel now that they keep bees, and kind of like the bees produce honey. So, we're starting to see some of our animal and some of our neighbors as something that we can share the land with, and we can, appropriate spaces that they can use a little bit more. So that's another theme that we think ties into indigeneity quite closely. Next, please. Next slide, please. Sorry, you skipped one there on me. If you can go back one. So this slide really speaks to, trying to incorporate a landscape that really kind of acknowledges the changing of the seasons. With a lot of our work, what we've been trying to do is incorporate plants that really show off at different times of the year. So there's always a very kind of an interesting palette. There's always something that's colorful, and something that kind of heightens the awareness of the changing of the seasons throughout the calendar year. Those children in the daycare, they'll be able to kind of look outside, and we'll have plants that show off in the early spring, and some that do well in the summer. So there's always a colorful palette that they can look at, that they can be inspired by, and that they can learn from. And also something I think we're always thinking about the 13 moons in the calendar year. And the first new moon in January is important to Indigenous people. So what can we do on the site to acknowledge some of those, celestial observances that are out there? So again, looking at the massing studies that have already been done, we're already seeing ways that we think we can do that. Next slide, please. I think sometimes as architects, one of the things we do is we over-design spaces. Sometimes we provide too much and we think we're making spaces interesting more architecturally, but I think it's always important to keep places for gathering fairly simple so that the people that are living there feel like they can appropriate the space for special gatherings, and the people can start to make forms like circles and talking circles, or like an interconnected dance. We do this circle dance often where the group spirals in on each other. So it's a very non-hierarchical demonstration. Everyone's treated with the same amount of respect. The individual that's a part of the circle is as important as anyone else. So I think thinking about some of those places that Sunny showed where people would want to naturally gather, we want to keep some of these ideas in mind that it could be used to support, an urban powwow, or it could be used to be support for, a market or a crafting bazaar, or any kind of these gatherings. Indigenous Day on June 21st, you know, there are all these kind of opportunities. So we want to make sure we provide some support, but that we don't make it too complicated. Next, please. I really like this painting a lot. It's one of the only ones that I've ever seen where 40% of its content is allocated to the underworld. The bugs, the earthworms. This talks about humans sharing resources with birds and animals and plants and insects. And so I always find this a very kind of a rich painting, and it always challenges me whenever I get involved in a project to really try to be inclusive and take inclusivity to a level that goes beyond people and starts to think about some of the beings that we share this planet with. Next. And I think this is my last slide, but next, please. We also want to kind of promote an architecture that celebrates the way that it's made. If you think about kind of like the modern international style, it was popular for a while, but it really did not do anything to reference specific place. And I think with the detailing, we want to kind of, we want to celebrate our Toronto location. We want to show off the skill and the craftsmanship of our laborers. We want to use materials and really express the joinery and the way those materials are coming together. Materials like wood and stone and steel all have their appropriate place in this project, we believe. So in some respects, I think some of the decoration could come from the way that it's made. If you think about, a birch bark canoe or a lacrosse stick, or a snowshoe, the way they're made and the way the wood is bent really it provides a functional purpose, but it's also very decorative and shows off a level of craftsmanship that we really like to see. So those are some of the themes that we've kind of identified. We're really looking forward to getting into the engagement sessions with the community to look at how some of these themes can be incorporated into the massing studies that SVN is currently working on. So thank you. I think I'm turning it over to Bob, right?
You bet. You bet. Bob, over to you.
Thanks very much, Brian. Hopefully everyone can hear me. I'm really happy to have that presentation by Brian. Really brings out a lot of the imagery and a lot of the spirit that Indigenous people, First Nations, Métis, and Inuit of many different nations can really bring this project, can really bring to placemaking in the city, across Canada.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I can't see you. And I think I think it would be so great if we could.
I'm doing my best.
All right, continue. But I just saw your camera go off when you started, so I thought if it was an easy fix, then we could do it. But if not, just continue. There you go. Nice.
There we go. I'm okay. Having trouble with WebEx all day today. Yeah.
Apologies.
It's a really great opportunity to share in the story of this family, this Mississauga or Mississauga family that lived in the area in around 1898. And the name of the family is the Kijigo family. Kijigo is our word for the sky. From the sky, that sky world where that name comes from. And part of the imagery that Brian shared is really our worldview, how we see the universe, the different layers of the universe, from the sky world, the star world, the spirit world, to even that world underneath our feet. And this is an opportunity through this placekeeping opportunity at Kijigo Lane to really start to reflect that in the city and reflect that in this development and this great open space. I really love that concept that we're going to take this laneway that is part of the urban infrastructure of the city, and make it truly a new accessible public space that acknowledges Indigenous families and acknowledges the history of the Mississaugi, history of Treaty 13 in the territory, and treaty of the many different nations that have called Toronto their home. So I'm looking forward to leading engagement in that. It's starting this Monday, December 14th at 6:30. It's a session specifically for First Nations, Métis, and Inuit people. Invitations have been sent to the different agencies and organizations across the city. So we're welcoming all you, if you identify as Indigenous, to come and join us. I do want to recognize Joanne Doucette of the Leslieville Historical Society. She was the one that came up and brought forward that idea of that name, Gijago Lane. So I really look forward to having those discussions. I thank Joanne for her contributions. Last thing I'm going to add is when it comes to engagement of First Nations, Métis, and Inuit people, there's three basic principles and guiding principles that really move things for me. And number one is to be respectful. We are going to aim to be respectful of each other, respectful of nationhood, and the different ways and the different ways of expression that we see as Indigenous people. The second is to be meaningful, that our engagement with First Nations, Métis, and Inuit is going to be meaningful from the eyes and perspective of Métis people. We're not going to say what's meaningful. They're going to tell us what's meaningful. And finally, we're going to be collaborative and really work with urban Indigenous agencies, as well as the rights-holding Indigenous communities, all the First Nations and the Métis Council, to really work from their perspective and to really be as collaborative as we can. So I look forward to working with all of you. I look forward to being a part of this great project. And thanks for your time today. Yiigwech.
Great. Chantal, you're wrapping it up. Matthew, you're going to put the final slide back there. Great.
So thank you, Bob and Sunny and Brian and Annalie for your presentations today, and Vladen as well. We're going to be moving into the discussion portion now of the meeting today. So Matthew, if you can flip to the next slide. These are the four questions that we will be walking through, and we'll be asking you to give us your feedback on. As Nicole mentioned earlier, if you don't feel like you want to provide an answer to this specific question, but you do have general feedback, please also feel free to share. Any of the feedback that we received today will help to inform the revisions to the preliminary development concept that you've seen. And when we return to you in the spring of next year, we'll be able to articulate how that feedback was incorporated in the refined design concept that was part of the our first zoning submission. So I'll just quickly read through these questions for you guys. The first is, what are some important features of the existing neighborhood that should be considered when redeveloping the site? Second, are there any opportunities to enhance the local neighborhood that you would like to be considered? If so, what are they? Do you have any concerns about the redevelopment of the site? What suggestions do you have, if any, on how these concerns could be best addressed? And then last, do you have any other comments or feedback for the Housing Now team? So with that, I'll pass it back over to you, Nicole, and we can begin hearing everybody's feedback.
Great. So what we're going to do now is I'm just going to take all of the participants. Looks like we have 62 people right now. So in addition to everybody you see on the screen, I'm just going to make you all panelists. So it means you have the opportunity to mute and unmute and to put on your camera and take off your camera. And we have two call-in users who can also actively participate. If you want to raise your hand, just press *3 on your phone and I'll make sure that I keep you in a speakers list queue. So I think it's are working not badly. We have, I think, three others that I'm having trouble making a panelist, or one other. Sometimes if you've joined by your mobile as opposed to a desktop, it can be hard to promote you to a panelist. But I'm just going to leave it at that for now. Vashti, I see you there, and I'm sorry for whatever reason. It's not working at the moment, but I think I've got everybody else covered. So maybe, Matthew, if you want to send me a little note, if there's any secret move I can do to promote folks that may not be working, then let me know. Otherwise, we'll go with the group we've got. So the floor is now yours. We have just under an hour. Two things I wanted to say. The deck, some of the fonts might have been hard for you to read depending on the screen you're on, especially if you're on a phone. It'll be online tomorrow, so you can go grab it. There's also an online feedback form, you can also, as I said at the beginning, request a hard copy of the materials if you prefer that. We'll mail it to you. You can mail it back. So what I want to do is first ask you, you've got the Housing Secretariat, the Councillor, CreateTO, City Planning. Do any of you have, you've got the design teams from Turo and SVN, you've got Bob as the engagement, Indigenous engagement lead. Do you have any questions for the team that you would like to ask? And I always say, I really encourage people to ask questions that will help inform the feedback that they share. And we'll take maybe 5 or 10 minutes of just the questions. Edith will start us off, if I say me saying your name right, Edith will start us off, and then I'll get Jeffrey and watch for more hands after that. So Edith, unmute yourself and take it away. Do you want me to give you a hand? Hang on, I'm gonna unmute you.
Thank you.
Okay, there you go.
Okay, I had jotted down a couple of questions. I wondered if, first of all, if there was a green roof being planned.
Okay.
What happens to the daycare during construction? And it's only meant to be 6 stories high, I guess, at the Eastern Avenue. And is there going to be a connection to the parkland from like a walkway or a crossing across Eastern Avenue?
Okay, good. I got four. Let's take a pause there, and then we can come back. Green roof planned. And maybe the same person can answer the height at Eastern. Who wants to take that?
Mladen and I can take that one.
Okay, great.
Mladen, take it away on green roofs and height.
Sure, yes. Green roofs are required under the bylaw to be provided for about 75% of the building roof, I think. So that'll be a requirement for a building permit once they come in for a building permit.
And okay, good.
For the height, SASP 466 specifies a maximum 6-story height along Queen Street West. So those are the SASP policies. We're going to adhere to those. We're also going to try to look into squeeze as much affordability as we can as part of this proposal. So right now, we haven't really determined what the exact height is along Eastern Avenue. We're still early in the process. But before they make the formal application, we're going to make sure that whatever is proposed does conform with our policies.
Okay, so that does the height on Eastern. The 6 is at Queen, not on Eastern. How about what happens to the daycare during construction, and will there be a connection to the park?
I will take the daycare one.
Yeah.
So the childcare center is planned to be temporarily relocated during construction. Now, the city and CreateTO, we're actively looking for a temporary space to relocate the existing childcare program in this capacity. We haven't found a spot as yet, but we are, as I mentioned, looking very diligently. And we're going to ensure that it is a smooth transition. And I just want to, again, just emphasize that we are providing an expanded childcare program once the new development comes back online. So increasing that capacity from 26 spaces to 62.
Okay. And last but not least, connection to the park. Will there be a connection to the park? And maybe that's planning or Sony, or you guys want to jump in?
Yeah. thank you, Edith. We've investigated that, and the crossing in terms of the distance between this location and Coxwell is a very short distance. So it's going to be something that would be tabled once the transportation consultant is on board to see if we can create a safe crossing for the park. or towards the park, because again, we want to make sure this is a safe and comfortable space, specifically the placekeeping location where we hope that there will be future gatherings. So we don't want to create or incent any kind of crossings that may lead to any potential collisions between pedestrians and drivers.
Okay, good. I've got a few people in the queue now, Jeffrey, Michael, and then Safira. Vashti, you can still raise your hand and I can still unmute you, even though I can't make you a panelist, but so far everybody that's joining, I've been making a panelist, and if you could mute yourself until it's your turn, that would be excellent. Okay, Jeffrey, question or comment?
I have two questions. The first is just confirming the height along Queen Street is six stories. When I looked at the diagram, it seemed it was eight that was listed. Maybe that was just a preliminary diagram that didn't bear any authority. But it's the Queen Street East guidelines have a maximum of six stories, and it would be unfortunate to for the guidelines and their integrity if we were to see the Don Somerville development has already way exceeded the six stories along Queen Street. And if we were to have another one, there would be, I guess, two precedents, which would lead future developers to say that the guideline, that the heights now are not a maximum of six, but a minimum of six. So that's number one, just confirmation. It would really be nice to see that this development respects the guidelines. The second question is the size of the units, whether they're going to be units which can accommodate families, or the, because again, the Don Somerville, it's a huge number of very, very huge percentage, it seems, of very small units.
So two things. On the height question, I know Paul Muehl is also on the call with us, and he's been very active on the Don Somerhill site. So I'll leave it really to Annalie or Mladen to nod to confirm that it would be good for Paul to take that.
Yes, I can take that.
Okay, go ahead, Paul.
Yes, I can speak to that. So thank you very much for that question. It in reference to, I would just resonate what Mladen already said. We have, you're right in pointing out, we have a set of urban design guidelines, and we're going to be looking at those urban design guidelines as our guiding direction. However, this is a city-initiated project, and we are going to, obviously, we need to look at the site in the context of what's being proposed here. So there, you know, we have an angular plane requirement along Queen Street East, which pushes the building mass back along Eastern Avenue. And you will most likely see a taller built form and a proposal for taller built form. Now, this doesn't mean we're promoting any particular built form, but we will be looking at that. And it's very true in saying that we don't know what that will be right now. This is part of this consultation process and this conversation. So I hope that answers that for you as best as I can. I was the planner on Don Somerville, so if there's anything else, I can
just
answer your question.
Just if I could follow up, I take from that it may well be over six stories.
You know what? I'm not going to disagree with you. That's certainly you've heard a lot of messages here today. That's not beat around the bush. It probably will. But there's an angular plane. We're looking at the neighborhood context, and not just the built form context, but we're looking at the neighborhood in the 360 perspective, right? We're looking at the urban design guidelines and the community all around this site to ensure that we have the appropriate.
Yeah, I guess not to belabor the point, but the concern is that with the Somerville development and this one over six stories, the next developer that comes will say, why should I be limited to six stories? Look at these ones, and we saw that along Kingston Road, that it seemed everybody would say whatever the person adjacent to them got, that's the minimum that they can expect and ask for more. So I guess it's just the way that these things seem to get a life of their own, and then eventually, whereas six stories was the aspirational goal for Queen Street, these two buildings, and then another one comes, and people are going to say, well, actually, the context here is not six stories. The context is anywhere from 12 to 17. So I guess there's nothing we can do with that, but we have noticed with following developments up Kingston Road that everyone was a little bit higher and bootstrapped on the previous one. So I guess we look at this second in close proximity as a nucleus which may well grow as larger sites are developed. So
point well taken,
thank you very much, Beth.
I think it's really important to point out that this site has, it has frontages on both Queen and Eastern. So if you see that preliminary concept that we've been looking at, there really are three parts to this building that the reference concept that we're working with right now and sharing with you today has. It has the Queen Street, it has the middle, and it has the taller element on Eastern Avenue. So it is very critical from planning's perspective to create good character on Queen Street while still hitting the objectives of this project, which are to provide 50% new affordable rental units, which we know that subsequent private developments will not be able to offer as you go along Queen Street.
Yes.
I'm just going to jump in. I think the point's taken. He doesn't want to see what's happening on Kingston. It's a concern. And I think we'll be back in with you guys for a second meeting. And I think it's a good one to come back and be able to explain what trends the planning department things may or may not unfold as a result of decisions made on two sites close by each. But very quickly, before I go to the next growing queue, Jeffrey's second question was about family units, family size units. Quick answer.
Jeffrey, City Council adopted the growing up Planning for Children and New Vertical Communities guidelines, which sets out three scales of how we should be looking at tall buildings to make high quality living environments for larger households. One of those scales is the unit scale. The urban designer on this file, Julie Bogdanovich, is one of the authors of that guideline. So you've got some people on this file who have been very intimately involved in that, who will be pushing for the building layout and units to adhere to those guidelines.
Okay, thank you, Jeffrey. I now have a much longer queue. And John, sorry, I muted you just because I was getting a little background, but I've got Michael, Safira, John, Mark R. Edith, do you mind if I put you at the bottom just because I want to go to people who haven't had a chance first? I've got Joy and Jan, and then I'd come to you again, if that's all right. I can't hear you, so 1 second. Is that all right if I go to some people who haven't spoken? Yes. Okay, thank you. Okay, good. So Michael G, over to you.
Good evening. I guess my question has already been brought up by the first three, my fellow residents, but it's in regards to the height. You know, I've been in the neighborhood for about 10 years and was involved with the Queen Street East visioning study. And, my understanding from that is there's an absolute limit of 18 and a half meters or six floors. You can't just do an angular plane back to some unlimited height, essentially. So, but I understand at the same time, you know, there needs to be affordable and housing and an increase in supply, and Eastern Avenue technically doesn't, you know, you could say that's a separate building. But I'm still a little, upset that even we can't make an effort to keep the building on Queen at six floors. Is there no way to hit the density goal but keep things at six floors and uphold the urban design guidelines? I mean, I see a lot of these buildings. It's another one on the Danforth and Woodbine on the corner. They have, at-grade parking and other little just nooks and crannies, for lack of a better word from, forget it, an architect, but just that, to me, you could fit 300 units in here and keep the whole thing six floors. So I don't know why we aren't looking at stuff like that. We keep talking about the missing middle in the city, and this really just undermines the community input from the urban design guidelines, in my opinion. It's not really a question, just, you've answered enough with the first three callers. That's just my input.
Okay, thanks, Michael. And I think the point is well taken. our firm actually facilitated those conversations 10 years ago. I'm also seeing some familiar faces and intimately familiar. Safira, are you still here?
Yes. Hi. Hi, everyone. Great. Good evening. And thank you very much for this presentation. Yeah, I love the idea. I just more so have comments and some considerations rather than questions.
Sure, go ahead.
I love the activation along Eastern Avenue. I think that's going to be beautiful for the neighborhood. I'm sort of in alignment with what Michael is saying about the height. I have heard about the visioning studies when they were implemented, to just really keep that into consideration in regards to the scale of the neighborhood. I'm just wondering if there is a sustainability target for this building, whether it's going to be a LEED certified building or targets towards net zero, using reclaimed materials and whatnot, which is a part of LEED as well. So if there's that happening with this project.
Okay.
I'm also wondering about public art. Because I know that I understand that there's going to be a piazza of some sort, monument or mural, which I realize like on the Danforth and has been happening more often in Toronto. And Toronto does have that target towards more public art in and around the city. And another thing that a lot of buildings tend to not have is sufficient bike storage inside of the buildings, as well as exterior. In terms of materiality and colors, I often find a lot of these buildings, condos are very drab looking, grays and whatnot, if there would be consideration to adding color to the facade, bright colors, if that's a consideration. I'm just wondering in terms of the application process for the affordable housing aspect of it. How does that work exactly? And is it like targeted to people in and around the neighborhood, or is there a way to advertise outside of the neighborhood to potentially increase diversity within the building? So I'm curious about that. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Okay, good. I've got 7 points. So I was hoping you might wrap. Let me cue who's got who here. Okay, so love the activation on Eastern. Heard about the visioning studies reinforcing those points. Okay, number three. Chantel, you want to take sustainability targets? Is this net zero? Is it LEED, reclaimed materials, et cetera? Then Safira, and how am I saying your name properly?
Safira.
That was perfect. Good. Okay, Safira. So Chantel, you can take sustainability maybe, but then she's also raising public art, bike storage, color to the facade, and then maybe Valessa, you can pick up when Chantel is done on the application process. Does that work? Okay, great. Chantel.
Okay, so for sustainability, it is a council direction that we meet at a minimum Toronto Green Standard version 3 tier 2. At Create Kyoto, we are modeling and exploring the ability to achieve Toronto Green Standard version 3 tier 4 on the phase 2 housing now sites. And then that is actually near net zero. It's not net zero, but it is very close to. So we'll be working with the architects and our design team to see what's possible. With respect to bike storage, we typically are, Annalie, you may want to jump in here actually, but I believe the ratio that we look to provide is a combined total of one bike parking space per unit, and that includes long-term and short-term bike parking storage. Hopefully I got that right, Annalie or Mladen, as the planners.
Yeah, the project will meet the bylaw, and it will also reflect the requirements of the Tier 4 green standard, which integrates the requirement for bike storage.
So maybe I'll go to Valessa, and then Brian, just give you a heads up in case you want to take the one about public art, color to facade, if only because the slides that you presented were the most focused on what kind of environment might be created there. So maybe if it's all right with you, I'll go to Valessa, and then you can wrap it up in responding to Safira. Valessa. application process? How does it work? Can you reach beyond the community, make it more diverse? How does it work?
You absolutely can. So thanks for the question. How it works is prior to about 6 months prior to completion of construction, city staff work with the selected developer and they define the tenant selection process. So tenants are selected from across the city. There's a qualification requirement based on income levels and a number of other requirements. So applicants are pre-screened and there's a pool of the pool of qualified applicants are then I guess further whittled down to match with the appropriate units based on a transparent process. So currently the city does an actual lottery process similar to Toronto Community Housing. We are working on updating our systems to make it an electronic process moving forward. To answer your question, yes, there is an ability to choose tenants from across the city, a diverse group of tenants who will be selected based on a transparent and predefined criteria.
Okay. Thanks, Valesa. Brian, do you want to jump in on the public art color to facade one part of it?
Sure. You know, we're seeing kind of a trend where, you know, there's a process that can be administered that would, you know, identify an artist that would be looking at doing installations, you know, at a urban civic scale. So we haven't got into those processes yet, but I think with that landscaped area along Kichigo Lane, there are three or four opportunities for those types of things. It'll be interesting the approach that we take with the children's playground for the daycare. A lot of daycares now are using, you know, they're going to very naturalized approaches where the play systems are on earth mounds, logs, so very, very natural, introducing a lot of wood and a lot of stone. I think we'll also want to take a look at that with the development of the facility itself, trying to incorporate natural materials where we can, where they can be protected and where they won't represent, you know, like a huge operations and maintenance issue. But I think also as Indigenous people, we really like saturated colors. We don't like drab either. So I think we really want to take a good look at that. And I was really encouraged by the example that Sunny showed of that other project that SVN did, where they, you know, some very bold colors, some nice blues, some nice greens. You know, I think that's something that we don't have to be afraid of, incorporating some rich colors. Also kind of like to help with wayfinding and really kind of expressing some of the verticality of the building. So really looking forward to some of the community sessions where we're sure some of those themes will come up again. But we really kind of want to avoid gray as much as possible. Thanks.
Perfect. Thank you. Okay, I've got six in my list. John, Mark, Joy, Jan, Emma, and then I'm coming to Edith. So John, thank you for your patience.
Hi, good evening, and thank you for the opportunity. I live in the immediate neighborhood. I live within about a 5-minute walk from that site, and actually my residence was shown on some of those overhead aerials. So I'm quite familiar with the area. And as a local resident, I'd like to provide a little bit of comments and feedback and some questions relative. One of the comments is really more about all of the new condo construction that's going on in that area. But what was identified in one of the slides, I believe, was there's three other condo developments currently under construction. One, Kingston Road being as an application, and this would be the fifth. So when you add all the units of housing there together, which I applaud the initiative that Housing Now and Create Toronto is trying to do from a affordable housing point of view, when you add it all together, I don't know the number of new housing units there will be, but I would estimate that it's in the 500-600 number or higher. And what I worry about is the cumulative impact that all of those homes and residences will have on the existing community, particularly when it comes to traffic and parking, and in particular during the busy summer when there are events at Woodbine Park. Now, we didn't experience that this year because of the pandemic, but typically Woodbine Park every weekend has major activities and brings in lots of traffic. We've had ideas like Exercise Toronto, which, you know, closes parts of Lakeshore, and, you know, anyone living in this area, you know, it can be a half hour to drive, you know, 2 miles to get, you know, from, say, the Gardner, the bottom of the Gardner, and Coxwell, Carlaw, you know, into this community to your home. So I really worry about the impact on traffic, and I worry about specifically with this unit, what there will be for visitor parking. Like, I think there's going to be 300 units here, so I don't know how many visitor parking spots, but if the plan or the assumption would be that visitors need to find parking somewhere in the community, it's already over congested, and that's just not really a viable option. So that's, you know, part of it is specific to this, but I think it's exacerbated with all the other developments going on, and I think the same problem will occur with a number of the other units. My second question and comment is about, I heard a number of times that the ground floor on Queen Street will be retail, and I understand why you would do that. I'm sure most of you are aware that further east on Queen Street between Kingston Road and Woodbine, there have been vacant retail spots that have been there for over 10 years. There have been some particular retail locations there that have not been rented in 10 years. So while there might be some retail there, and I think many of you are aware, if you're familiar with that area, in the last year, there have been two very, very long-term businesses, the Tulip and Meat on the Beach, that closed recently in the past year. And this was even before, you know, the impact of the pandemic. So while I understand retail, I wonder from a business point of view, is it really viable? Like, you know, maybe there's a better use of that space than retail, because if it's just going to sit empty, it's just an eyesore. Okay. And then my third comment question is around the Harvey's piece. To me, that just sticks out that is there and that is not dealt with. And I just have a hard time believing that is a thriving business that will be there in 5 years' time. I think this is going to be constructed in 2025. And I don't know if there's options. Like, could you do something much greater with this opportunity if you could access that Harvey's plot of land?
Okay.
So thank
Good.
You.
Those thank are three you. Big
the
ones.
The presentation was very well done. I appreciate it. Thanks.
Thank you, John. And I think we've got people lined up on the transportation side. I think Paul, around traffic and parking, is that sure. one for you?
Yeah.
And then after that, we'll make sure somebody gets to retail. I mean, it's a question on everybody's mind these days, especially. And then Chantel on Harvey's. I don't know if Chantel, you can also do retail potentially, or if you can signal somebody else. But Paul.
Sure. I'll take on. So the visitor, in terms of traffic, I understand. If you were following the Don Somerville project, we required the developer to look at the whole area, and they looked at the traffic considerations, and through this application, the transportation requirements will make sure that we looked at the whole area here. Woodbine, Woodford, we'll be looking at all the streets, feeder streets that come into Queen Street. So, and just so you know, nothing gets approved unless the appropriate servicing is there, and that includes transportation. So we look at that. So we ensure that the appropriate transportation solution and servicing solution is there to be able to support the development. So I just want to park that for a second. In terms of visitor parking, what we did with Don Somerville is we understand what happens in these neighborhoods. The streets are not that big, and there's not a lot of on-street parking, and we don't want to flood the streets with parking permits. So oftentimes, unfortunately, because you're, and it's kind of a paradox, because you live on Queen Street, there's a great LRT there. We spent billions of dollars to implement this. It is a great opportunity for people to take transit and to cycle, in addition to drive a car if you want. However, we oftentimes have part of our decision and approval of development is to ensure that certain developments can't use on-street parking. So we write that right into the approval. And we require visitor parking on site as well. Just so you know, this is a transit oriented area. So we do reduce the amount of parking given the access to this great transportation system we have. I just want to say one thing really quickly about the retail. I'm sure others will have something to say. So through this site and through a lot of other sites, we actually looked at all the retail uses all the way from St. Joe's Hospital all the way to the other end of Queen Street. We looked at all the uses, and in general, I have to say that there's a wide range of commercial retail uses, and they have been growing. They used to be about 150 square meters, which is your traditional little hamburger joint, and they're getting bigger and bigger. And like the Tulip was a little larger. Tulip was there probably, what, 40 years? I know it very well. And unfortunately, what we can do in planning is we can try to make it so that we maintain, we have the balance here is to maintain a fine retail character, that 7 meter typical store frontage that you like to see that we all want to maintain as part of this district. But at the same time, allow flexibility so that there's breathing room for new guys that come in and want to open up, you know, things that are maybe a little different, that require a little more space, taller floor plates, a little more room for ventilation and HVAC, things that, you know, 100 years ago, we didn't have an HVAC, we had fans. So we have to think about these things, and we're really trying to ensure that we're being as inclusive as possible to make the retail work and that you're not getting one big user.
Okay, let's go to Harvey's, and I don't know if Chantel, you also want to weigh in on the retail front.
No, you know, I think that Paul did a great job answering that. We want to ensure, obviously, that the development partner has the ability to demise the unit as they see fit at the time of construction, so that it's marketable. With respect to the Harveys, we know that sticks out, but unfortunately, we don't control how that site is used or what the owner is going to do with that site in the future. So I hope that answers your question.
But were you guys interested in that site at all, Chantel? Is there any story behind that site? Is that something that,
like, yes, originally
you don't control what they do, obviously.
Correct. Yeah. So I guess originally, you know, as Annalee noted at the top of the presentation, the key principle of Housing Now is to leverage city-owned land to build affordable housing. So we're taking the value of that land to build affordable housing. When you look at acquiring a property that is market value, it actually hurts our ability to deliver on that affordable housing component. So I think that's the long and short of it. It's not a traditional, condo development. We're building purpose-built rental here. And so we have to make the program work for that priority.
Thank you. I think people, they pay close attention to how and why the city's making decisions. And I think the more transparent we could be about that. So I think that was super helpful. Okay. So Mark, and then Joy, and then Jan, and then Emma, and then Edith. Mark, over to you.
Unmuted, hopefully.
You betcha.
Excellent. So I'm also a 20-something year resident in the ward, live close to the site. I am the technical lead and a volunteer with the housingnowto.com group. 10 years ago, when we were talking about these Queen Street guidelines, there were people in those meetings saying that if you do six stories, if you do angular planes, if you do all the parking requirements, you can't make affordable housing work with all those constraints. We've had the same discussions with the West Queen West, Bathurst to Roncesvalles, and we're having similar conversations now around Queen and Broadview area. We have to start writing into our heritage designations and our urban design guidelines, these things don't apply if you're building affordable housing. We're sort of trying to dance on the head of a pin here. We could do probably six or seven, maybe eight stories along the south side of Queen Street. It wouldn't cast a meaningful shadow on the north side. we could reduce the angular plane requirement. We could probably get this site, I think you're at 300 units with 50% affordable right now. We could probably increase that. But we've handcuffed ourselves in this city by creating guidelines to keep evil mustache twirling developers, as some people believe they are, out of our communities. But if you do that, you hamstring the city's own ability to deliver affordable housing at speed, at scale. We can't just wave a magic wand and undo these guidelines. But for everybody who's on here defending these guidelines, a decade ago, you were told that this was going to be the outcome when affordable housing developers tried to build within those constraints. So I'm fully supportive of this site. I'd like to see it get bigger. I'd like to see us, you know, try and get 25% bigger on this site. Maybe if we could get 25% bigger, we could make a better deal with the Harvey's owner. Part of the constraints of trying to acquire land is he probably wants what a private developer could give him. Well, if we're tying our hands with urban design guidelines, we can't make those kinds of deals at the city. We need more affordable housing. This is a great location. It's a transit-served location. There's tons of parking directly south of this site, directly south of the movie theater. Don't freak out about the parking. And please move this one along as quickly as you can and as boldly as you can. We really want you to succeed.
Mark, I think Annalie's gonna jump in. And just one of the points I want to make before she says is that I think this is our sixth site talking about housing now. And the range, I think the city's literacy on affordable housing and development is increasing significantly. And the range of perspectives is something that we work very hard to protect the space for all of those different perspectives to come out. And so I'm happy to hear sort of some of the range coming out here, because what we have to do if we want to live together in some kind of social peace is understand and respect the other and then negotiate where to find the space, right? So to try and meet. And at least that's one way to look at it if you're a facilitator trying to find common ground. So in that spirit, I think it's very, and the burden of the city, of course, is to try and find that common ground. That's the burden of public service. In that spirit, that's why we do these processes the way we do. And I just use it as an opportunity for Annalie then maybe to respond. Mark asked, I think the biggest question I would get out is, can you go bigger? Can you go bolder? Can you get, you know, even 25% bigger?
Can you ignore some of the guidelines because it's affordable housing?
Can you ignore some of the guidelines because it's affordable? Thank you. Yeah, over to you.
Yeah, thanks. And I just want to say, no, we're not going to ignore the guidelines. The guidelines are the result of public processes. But what we're going to do is review those guidelines very closely to see how they impact how we can deliver affordable housing. So the guidelines are not going to be thrown away out of hand. There are some great pieces to those guidelines. And in fact, some of the qualities of Queen Street that make it so attractive are the scale of the built form. But we know this site is an irregular site, and it has frontage on two very different kinds of streets. So what we're going to do is look at how we can continue to respect the work that the community has done to share their what they've loved about the community for new sites that are coming on board, with balancing the need to absolutely maximize the potential of the site. You know, right now it's zoned at 2x coverage. We are not looking at maintaining a 2x coverage site. So we are not going to stay within the existing framework that is in place. And that's why we're here today. We have a lot of different objectives for every Housing Now site. Principally is affordable housing, but being good city builders and stewards of our own land is also critical. So as Jeffrey mentioned at the beginning, when you start throwing everything out the window, we start ending up with a built form that meets a lot of opposition down the road. And we just want to be very clear that affordable housing is a central objective, but we have a very unique site that offers a lot of opportunity to provide density in different locations. But Queen Street is a very important street in the city, and we're going to continue to adhere to the components of those guidelines that support the quality of life and the design of Queen.
Okay, Joy, Jan, Emma, Edith. Joy, over to you.
This has been This has been just terrific. I'm really enjoying this event. John stole my thunder about Harvey's. I too had wondered about whether the city could purchase that, and thank you for the answer to that. The second question was this. I was very much drawn by the indigenous element around the design, and I wondered about the potential early on to identify a nonprofit indigenous housing partner who would ensure that some of the families that are moving in to the building are indigenous.
I wonder, Valesa, do you want to talk to what the Housing Secretariat has already been doing, or if you combo Chantel?
Sure. So the Housing Secretariat is currently working with a number of Indigenous partners. We have an Indigenous stakeholder table. We meet on a monthly basis to look at upcoming opportunities for affordable housing, as well as affordability in general. So whether it's a new affordable housing being built or housing allowances and subsidies that can facilitate Indigenous people getting access into housing that's across the city. So that's some of the work that's been ongoing. For some of the Housing Now sites specifically, we will be doing further engagement with that community, with our stakeholders, to look at some options that may be rightfully well suited for ownership as opposed to a longer term lease, considering the cultural aspect of that part of the program as well. So great work ongoing. There's a lot more to be done with Indigenous specifically, but also with other equity serving groups across the city. So I hope that answers your question. While a final decision hasn't been made with respect to the site or other sites in general, the work is ongoing to identify possible opportunities.
Okay. Any Chantel, you want to add to that, or are we good? Okay, great. So Joy, after Joy, I've got Jan, Emma, and Miguel, and then Edith. So Jan, thanks for your patience.
You're welcome. Interesting discussion so far. I'm concerned about the height of the building. I live in the area, and I can actually see the site from my house. So I'm not sure about what exactly is going on in the other developments that you talked about, but I think they're like 10-story and 17-story already. And I'm aware of the guidelines for the Queen Street East corridor, so that would be my number one concern. A lot of my other points were ticked off as I listened to the other questions. So the obvious Harvey's is anybody who looks at the drawing on the plan, that's the first question they'd ask. The retail, I echo John V's comments on that. I've been living south of retail stores on Queen East, 300 yards east of where this site is, and they've been empty for many, many years, and it's unfortunate. I think retail is going to suffer, and I wouldn't want the city to be paying for empty space. I'd rather, increase the size of the childcare. I think that would be a more useful space for that. The other comments about parking, this site is there's hundreds of parking spaces in a very overlit area just south of it. And that seems to be kind of adopted for trailer parking and commercial vehicle parking long-term. So there's all kinds of trucks and various other vehicles, and there are people living there in the summer. So there's also a car park right next to the health center and a car park in Harvey's. So there's like this site is surrounded on three sides by car parks, which is unpleasant for anybody living there. Obviously, getting rid of Harvey's would get rid of one car park. The crossing, I think somebody mentioned a connection to the park early on. There is a mid-block crossing, which is just south of the lane. it's a push button access. It doesn't, you know, you can get across the road. It's easy enough to get to the park from there. It's 20 meters probably. The only other comment I would have, I think that's probably the points I'd raise.
Okay, thanks.
So far. So I'm just kind of I'm reiterating concerns about height primarily, and that would be my concern.
Okay, good. And that's, I think, the point is well taken by the folks from CreateTO and the city listening. Emma.
Hi there. Thanks so much for taking my call and for the presentation this afternoon. This evening. I had 2 points of consideration with regard to the project. As a millennial urbanite, I usually would be taking the streetcar every day to and from work downtown, and it's already extremely busy and used and some points overcrowded. Obviously, now the situation is a little bit different, but considering 2025 is much farther down the pipeline, is there any consideration how public transportation will be adapted in order to accommodate for all these new developments? I mean, I'm in total favor of them, and the area definitely needs more affordable housing and mixed-use type living environments, but that's a huge concern of ours as people who do take public transportation. It's already quite strenuous. My other thought or point of consideration would be how the design or architecture or aesthetic of the building will fit into the neighborhood. It's quite a historic type neighborhood with very many old buildings. And a lot of times, a lot of these developments, as you can already see from the ones that are in progress in the area, are large glass iron industrial boxes that don't really fit into the unique character of the neighborhood. There was a few developments on the south side of Queen by Jimmy Simpson Park over in the Leslieville Riverside area recently that were built that I feel did a good job to knit into the existing area and at least the street side of it. Kind of knit it in so it's not as obvious. So just wondering what considerations are being taken on those two fronts.
Okay, lovely. And because I've still got 2 people after you and we've got just about 3 or 4 minutes for this, maybe we'll go quick. So any thinking around TTC? Paul, do you want to jump in as another person on the Queen East car? I know it's jammed.
I can just mention that briefly. So when they do make a formal application, the proposal will be circulated to TTC, and they'll keep track of all the data, who is moving into the neighborhood, how many units are going to get approved, so they can make sort of analysis down the road and improve the track service if they need to.
Okay, Mladen, thank you. Next one, about the design fitting in with the neighborhood, not putting in something that's, you know, kind of foreign to what's there.
Yes, I can answer that really quickly. And in my experience, one of the great things about these urban design guidelines is they really looked at the public realm. We really looked at how to maintain the character of this area within the approval, and that goes to maintaining a fine-grained, narrower street front. So not, you know, what you're expecting, a 3 or 4 meter, something really, really narrow, maybe something a little wider, but we will be looking at that retail store frontage. We have a required height limit along Queen Street of 12.5 meters within that range. So that maintains that fine-grained, human scale, smaller scale along the retail edge. And in terms of materiality, we always like to achieve a mix of materials and something that attempts to reference existing character along the street. So it's not all glass and metal, that there's a mix of different materials.
Okay, thank you.
We have to just acknowledge that we have two-row architect on this project, and that one of the key principles here is that we are looking to build in indigeneity. And so I'm going to pass it over to Brian to see if he has any comments on that, because I think that what Emma said really speaks directly to that.
Yeah, thanks for that. We've come up across this this topic, you know, a number of times before, where you're wanting to do something that's complementary to the streetscape. Because sometimes what we've done is we've taken you know, maybe a brick pattern, but done it in a different way, where instead of trying to mimic sort of, you know, kind of a European defensive kind of detailing, we'll take it and we'll maybe do something that's a little bit more, a little more crafted, like maybe a basket weave or some sort of a pattern that might get its influence from beadwork or some of the wampum designs that are out there. I mean, it's kind of a fine line. You don't want it to become, you know, a cartoon or a caricature, but if you can kind of convey some of those patterns that have a long, you know, standing history, do them in a way that's appropriate and authentic, we can get some mileage out of that, I think. When we did a project for Anishinaabe Homes on Dundas Street, just a little bit west of Parliament, that was sort of the game plan, was to try to, you know, acknowledge the build-to line that the city wanted out of brick, and then we went to kind of like a lighter metal above that. So I think there's ways you can do it where at the end of the day it looks crafted, it looks contextural, but it also makes some of these heritage references that we all want to see. So that's how I would answer that question.
Okay. Wonderful. Thank you. And for the push, Annalie. Miguel, and then Edith, and then we're going to wrap up. Thanks for your patience.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for your time. This is great. I am a supporter of more affordable housing. I live on Queen Street, just a block or two east of Kingston Road, so I'm familiar with the site. I drive a car, but I do realize things are changing. I try to bike, I try to take TTC more often. But I am concerned about this project, not necessarily, but the combined new residents moving in, a new concert hall moving in. It is very busy here in the summertime. So I'm just worried about that a little bit. I'm wondering about new services that are being introduced, such as libraries, recreation centers, if any of that's been taken under consideration. My other question thought is about the retail. I support small businesses, and I don't want to see big Walmart open up on Eastern Avenue down the road. Lots of space down there. I do like the idea of walking around, visiting small stores on Queen, but yes, there is a lot of empty units in the bottom of my condo. There's a few. I'm just curious about who will own the property of the retail. Well, the money be put back into the city, because if that's the case, that sounds like maybe a great idea. That's my thoughts, questions.
Okay, who's good for community services? A bunch of new people coming in?
I can take it really quickly, Nicole. Thanks for your question, Miguel. Community services and facilities are key. Obviously, the main contribution that this project is making is through the expansion to the childcare facility from the 26 to the 62 spaces, which is a very significant contribution. And another key contribution for community elements we always look to in the city is affordable housing. So this is obviously 50% of the 50% of the project is meeting a broader community need, which is for affordable housing.
Okay, and can somebody speak to who would own the retail? Chantel, you want to jump in?
Sure, I can speak to that. So Housing Now is operated through 99-year leases. So the development partner would sign a lease with the City of Toronto. And so they would operate the retail space, but the land is still owned by the city.
Okay. Last but not least, Edith, and I'll reiterate all the different ways you can also continue to share feedback, because I appreciate that, you know, sometimes when we have a lot of hands, it can't get to everybody. But Edith, do you want to wrap up with your second question or point?
Yeah,
or comment?
It's not a question so much as I am concerned, as Jan is, about the height on Eastern Avenue. I 100% support more childcare spaces. My children attended that one daycare when they were little. They're now grandparents themselves. So, and as far as the retail space is concerned, I again say there's a lot of empty spaces along Queen Street. And I don't see that we need retail space right there. And that's me. Okay.
Good. Wonderful. I'm going to turn it to Annalie and Chantel to wrap up. But I just want to say, on the one hand, we're hearing you loud and clear, concerns about traffic and parking, especially because it's a very sought after area. People come to the beach, they come to this area to get to the parks, they get to the water. So hear you on the concerns there. Obviously lots of comments related to the urban design guidelines and the work that many of you did to inform those, and concerns about the height and the retail, the viability of the retail. On the other hand, a couple of voices at least saying be bolder, do more. And then in the middle, some interest, not in the middle, but other points of interest that just really weren't maybe highlighted in the presentation. People talking about wanting to see green, sustainable, public art, design that fits locally, connect to the park, and the Molar Childcare. So we'll do a summary. We're not going to make it verbatim. Nobody reads verbatim notes, but take a look at the summary because it's a draft, and make sure we get the points right. And I'll turn it over. And I don't know if the counselor also wants to say anything as we wrap up, but you can nod or not. It's up to you. Yes. Okay. Annalie, Chantel, we'll give the last, or you want to go, counselor, and then we'll go to the other two?
Not overly important to the order, but do want to thanks everyone. Still 50 folks on the line here, and you stuck with us for the 2 hours of the evening. So I've been taking notes, as has Claudine and Rishabh on the line and the project team. Appreciate that feedback. And as we said at the top, there's a lot of things to consider here. Our priority, of course, is affordable housing. But this is a very special spot and a gateway to the community, and it's a great opportunity to do something really spectacular here. So looking forward to continuing the conversation, and huge thanks to the project team. You guys are definitely going to deliver on this. So thanks very much.
All right.
Thanks, Councillor Bradford. Just to close in, we are going to be out again, as Chantel mentioned. So this is not the only time. And I think a lot of the questions that came up today, as Nicole summarized, also will fit in to some of the work we're doing on Indigenous design in terms of placekeeping and art. And then finally, when we get to the site plan stage, there will be a consultation there with the future developer. And that is something that's very unique in the city, to get to consult at the site plan stage. So this is not our last conversation, it's our first conversation. And thank you for the range of feedback.
Thank you. And I'll just echo what Councillor Bradford and Annalie were saying. We really want to thank you guys for taking the time out of your evenings at the start of the week to join us today and share your thoughts, concerns, and feedback. If you were not able to provide your feedback today, we weren't able to get to you, please check out our website on createto.ca. And I think you have until January 11th to fill out the feedback form. So all of the feedback that we've received today and the feedback that we'll get from the online form will help to revise the preliminary development concept prior to our first zoning submission. So your feedback is very important to us. It will help us move this project along in a positive direction that you'll all be able to advocate and support. So thank you again. We'll see you guys in the spring, and I think
before that you'll get some notes from us. Take a look, draft, and enjoy the holidays as much as we can under these trying circumstances. Thanks a lot, everybody, and good night.
Hey, thank you.